So what comes next? Of course, you're going to have those confirmation hearings, and it's already, but we hurry up and wait because it's not going to happen until coming up, what, September, October? I mean, you have anywhere from 70 to 80 some odd days between the selection process to the confirmation process. Although it's already being billed as a knockdown, drag out fight that's going to consume all of D.C., but let's be a little bit realistic here. It's all theatrics. The Republicans hold majority. And only Republicans that, and really the only Republicans that may have caused any confirmation issues at all whatsoever, Susan Collins and Lisa Murkowski, they've already once voted to confirm Kavanaugh in the past. Secondly, they signaled today that they're content with and pleased with the president's selection, which was a huge signal to Chuck Schumer that he cannot rely on them as some sort of, as a safety net. That's it. Murkowski and Collins are gone. Any fight is going to be little more than theater heading into a midterm election. I mean, midterms, which the Democrats look less and less like they're going to be happy with. I see fewer victories ahead. And Democrats are in a very tough spot. We just mentioned a little bit earlier Dick Durbin and those red state Democrats, because there's nothing, there's about nothing that energizes Republicans and getting out the vote on the GOP side like a Supreme Court confirmation looming. But Democrats, given how rabid that socialist base is becoming with the resistance, well, they're going to have to play up that outrage factor tenfold to keep the base happy, to make it look like they're getting some victories, to make it look like they're really in the fight. But yet, that's the double-edged sword, because doing so is only going to do two things. It's going to further ensure that Republicans come out in record numbers. And secondly, it's also going to alienate the more moderate factions of the Democrat Party. You know, the Joe Manchins of the Democrat Party, the moderate blue-collar workers, many of which went for Trump, many of which Democrats need to regain if they ever expect to get numbers again in the Senate and the House. So it's quite a pickle. And if they passively get out of the way and they allow confirmation without much fanfare, then they suppress their own voter turnout. But then if they scream through bullhorns that the world is ending, then they're going to energize their opposition. So either way they move, it's a lose-lose situation for them. But, I mean, you can't feel too bad for them because they made this mess. They made this bed. Now they have to lay in it. They're the ones that transition to only speaking a language of outrage. And as a result, they have a base of support that's only going to be happy with that sort of rhetoric, with those protests that we've seen and the confronting people in the restaurants and screaming, "We know where you live, Mitch McConnell." And they've done this to themselves. They played footsie with the unhinged sections of their base. And now this is the end result. And they're expecting, I mean, honestly, if I was a red state Democrat, I think I'd be pretty upset with party leadership at this moment, because they're expecting these individuals to hold the line. I mean, they're Dick Durbin's calling to actively sacrifice Senate numbers. So what? You can block a nomination that most of those in Congress have already supported, that most of y'all in the Senate have already voted to confirm with the D.C. Circuit? I mean, particularly someone where you can't really make a lot of hay from his records because he's such a textualist. Better luck next time.